Okay, so over to part three of this presentation. I have to mention that part two and part three are based on blogs. Part two is a blog by Jasper, which is already on uniface.info. I can really recommend for you all to read this blog because it has more details than I can put in some PowerPoint slides, of course. And you can really it can really help you to understand and to play around with these properties. The modernization plan in 10 easy steps is I would always say almost say a trilogy by Theo, which means he wrote three blogs on uniface.info, and we're going over this plan in this part. So back to the requirements of the UDE, the Uniface 9.7 UDE. It should have a new start page. A white background should it have, because gray is sort of associated with old-fashioned. White background is nowadays sort of common sense and sort of professional looking. Any other background colors are not that professional looking. As said before, the idea was having flat buttons in a Windows 8 or Windows 10 style. It should have a fresh look. It should differ from UniFace 9.6, and this project should be done in low cost and low time. Time is money, of course. So here is a URL which shows the blog post that I mentioned before. All URLs in the PowerPoint are clickable and will lead you towards the blog. And we will make sure that the PowerPoint will be on SlideShare well late this afternoon or early tomorrow morning. So it will be available for you, as will be the recording. So the start page. Again, the difference between UniFace 9.6 and previous versions and the UniFace 9.7. I already elaborated on the details of the start screen. So what about the colors and the buttons and the menus and the panels? Well, the white background, here it is. This is the old version of the screen. Here's a new version, old version, new version, going from gray to white, going from this type of button to this type of button. I can't see the mouse. Oh, okay.
You'd have to point.
Okay. So I just got some feedback from Christy that obviously you people cannot see my mouse moving. So I will take that into account. So to get this white background, yeah, this seems fairly simple. Make the background of all forms white. That will be the goal. This can be accomplished by a simple change in the .ini file. Included in this step is altering the application shell, the menus, and the panels so they look nice in combination with the white forms. These are the actual values that are now in the .ini file for the UniFace 9.7 UDE. You see the back color white for all the windows, and the shell has a sort of very light blue color. And here are the values that are used. As you can see, the team made the application shell very light blue for a subtle color difference between the forms and the application shell. Forms were given a white background. Menus are now white with a blue selection color, and the panels are white with blue accepts. This was all done with the properties that already existed in UniFace 9.6 and earlier. The challenge. In theory, changing the .ini settings should be enough, but unfortunately, a small percentage of the forms had either an index color or foreground color or a background color set. That was never noticed before because these were set to the default gray background and the black foreground, so they did not stand out on the gray screens before. So after the changing the .ini file, these forms remained gray. The challenge is to find all forms with a color and remove the color with minimal effort. And the team, mainly Theo, has built some tools, and these tools are also available for download. These tools are not supported by Uniface, so use them at your own risk. And I would always advise to create a sort of sandbox development environment for yourself to start with. And of course, use proper staging and version control, as every developer should. This first tool for step one is called the U97_form_color. No pointer. So if you would hit the retrieve button, second button from the left, it will show all forms in your dictionary that have an index color or form property color set. It uses your current settings in the foreground / normal and the background / normal sections of your current .ini file to translate the index color to foreground and background color. It will also show what window color you have set in the .ini file. There are buttons to convert RGB values to hex value colors and vice versa. These are in the middle of the form. And there are buttons to put the index color in the Windows properties and remove the index color. One that only does that when there is no window property color, and one that does it always, two separate buttons on the form. And there is a button to remove the property color when it's the same as the .ini color. Nothing gets stored until you press the store button, the one on the right. So you can play around a little without actually modifying your property yet. And of course, you're completely free to, once you've downloaded these tools, to change the tool and change them to for your own purposes. Going over to step two of this modernization plan. Here's an example of some strange gray areas in a white form. Strange gray blobs on some of the nice white screens. What is this? Some of the painted entities had an index color or foreground color or background color set and were painted as markers for referential integrity or other technical reasons. This must sound very familiar to Uniface developers because it's the way things are done in Uniface development, mainly in client server, back from the old days as well. To be precise, these only show up when they are painted three or more characters cells wide. The team needed to remove these colors as well. The challenge in this step is to find all painted entities on all forms that have a color set and to remove the colors with minimal effort. Using SQL is not an option, as the index color for the painted entities is stored in the paint area, the form pick. So here comes another tool. Oh, it's not on my slide. Anyway, there is a small tool to search for painted entities with a color and a few additional buttons to manipulate or remove the color. Since the index color of a painted entity is stored in the form paint tableau, the team had some fun deciphering and manipulating that. The tool is called U97_AndColorForm. When you press retrieve, it will retrieve all painted entities that have an index color or an entity property color set. On a large dictionary, this can take some time, as it has to search the paint areas, the form picks, for the index colors. All buttons on this tool have the same function as on the previous tool. And I will show all of these tools in the demo part later on. So in step three. After step two, there were still unfortunately a few gray blobs like these. Some entities had a foreground or background color set in the application model. So no index color there. And they were painted as markers for referential integrity or other technical reasons. So this step three is pretty similar to step two. These colors needed to be removed as well. The challenge was to find all entities in all models that have a color set and remove it with minimal effort. The tool is called U97 and ColorMod. It searches for modeled entities with a color and has a few additional buttons to manipulate or remove the color. It works very similar to the previous tools. The differences are caused by entities in the application model not having index colors. Getting to step four of this modernization project. The visibility of grids. A grid always has a white background, and on our now white forms, it was not so clear to see what area a grid was occupying on a form, like you see on the left. So borders were needed around these grids. And to get these borders, the new Uniface 97 properties were used, namely border type flat and border color equals silver, as you see on the right, and then you get the form on the right. The challenge in this step was to find all painted grids and to apply this change, so border type and border color, with minimal effort. And again, there is some tooling. The tool is called U97 Grid Border. This one was kept very simple. It just retrieves all the entities that are painted as grids, and it has a button and to add properties to them. I will show you this tool in a demo later on also. Going to step five, multi-occurrence entities. This was an issue that was specific for the lab project of the modernization of the Uniface UDE, but we thought it would be interesting enough to include it in this presentation, because you may want to update properties of non-grid entities too. Earlier, the team removed the color from all entities, but in the development environment, there are multi-occurrence entities that need to look similar to grids. So someone tried very hard to imitate a grid, perhaps even before the grid was invented. Since grids do not follow the background color of the form, but always stay white, the team had to make these multi-occurrence entities consistent with that. Like in step four, a white data area on a white form does not look so good without some kind of border. So the team wanted to add new properties for the entity frame too. And in Uniface 97, there are these new properties for the default entity: border color, border type, border radius, drop shadow color, back color start, back color fill, gradient start, attach and attach margin. So again, border type flat and border color equals silver. And then you get the picture on the right. Just popping back to step five. The challenge was finding all painted entities that are not using a grid widget and are painted with a vertical repetition of occurrences. This information is stored in the form paint. Applying border color equals silver and border type equals flat to those entities. And again, there's a tool. The tool is called U97_multi_org. When you press retrieve, it shows all entities that are painted with an occurrence repetition and that is not a grid. It can be slow on large dictionaries, this tool also needs to look in the paint area of the form for each painted entity. Functionality is simple, just a button to add some properties to all painted entities found. So over to step six, the buttons. In this final episode of the story about the modernization of the Uniface 96 UDE in 10 easy steps, we will explain how the team changed the look of the buttons from this old gray to the white with the blue buttons. And again, changing the button also seems simple. just changing the .ini file, but there are some buts. In every application, you will probably have a group of buttons. For instance, the buttons on the lower part of a screen, often containing the OK and the Cancel button. Most applications will have a set of buttons on the right side of the of a screen. So these have to be logically grouped, and the lab team came down to this grouping, namely the IDF button bottom for the big buttons at the bottom of the forms, IDF button side for the big text buttons at the right hand side of the forms, IDF button special for all the other buttons that did not fall in the first two categories, IDF button image for the very small buttons with an image on them, like the more button, and lastly the IDF button header for the buttons that form the headers of simulated grids, so the column-like things where you can click on to sort. So flat buttons seems simple, but steps 7, 8, and 9 are closely related. And for that, you have to take a look at the inheritance of properties, which of course goes from down in this picture, the logical widget in the .ini file, gets overruled by the modeled field, which then gets overruled by a field painted on a component. So in step 7, the modeled widgets must be matched with the painted widgets. Put most used logical widget in the model. Step 8, set the properties on the painted buttons. Remove as much as possible to enable control via the .ini file. And step 9, set properties on modeled buttons. Remove as much as possible to enable control via the .ini file, because this is what you want. And step 10, at last. Testing, of course. With a project like this, functionality is not really touched, so nothing should fall over, and functionality should be fine. But does everything look okay? There could be opportunities where a local variation of a button has a reason, and perhaps now with the tooling you have removed that. And that should then be visible in your testing. And again, I strongly advise to use proper staging and version control in every form of development. So also in a project like this. Referring once again to the blog posts on uniface.info for much more details on each step of this 10-step plan, much more details than I can show you in some PowerPoint slides on the WebEx. The URLs link directly to part 1, part 2, and part 3 of Theo's blog. And the other URL is links directly to a zip file which contains all the tools for the 10-step plan. Please take also a proper look at the big yellow disclaimer saying the tools described in this posting are not supported Uniface software. You can download them and use them, modify to your own taste, and use them at your own risk. You will need the DICT model to be present in your repository before you can compile and use the tool. Be absolutely sure you have a backup of your dictionary before using any of these tools. You can download the tools in that link, or in the link on top of the slide. It's to the same URL. If you make an improvement to these tools that might be useful to the community, please share them. We like to learn from you. So shortly getting back to the freshness of Uniface 9.7. Blue colors were selected for buttons, menus, panels, and the application shell. And the small image buttons have no button shape behind those. And here is a good overview of the differences between 9.6 and 9.7. 9.6 on the top left and 9.7 in the center of the slide. And yeah, you can you have a good overview of all the different look and feel. Because this project was done on the budget, there it's not perfect. So there are some known issues and things to keep in mind. For instance, the frames of the widgets are not fully consistent. It was camouflaged by the gray background of forms, but it shows more clearly on white. Also, new entity frame properties work fine, but in a multi-occurrence situation where the entity is made to look like a grid, they have some visual imperfections. And third, the buttons in the IDF used to have images on them in Uniface 7, but not since then. These are still image buttons. In 9.6, that was not a problem because we used the representation equals windows for the buttons. But flat buttons have representation equals Uniface. So now the image prevents correct centering of the text in these buttons. So there's some more stuff, sort of bonus. It's now finally, I would say, possible to set the IDF title bar in your ASN file. It's done in the logical section of your ASN file by saying IDF title equals, and yeah, you can then define your own title for your IDF. And it's very useful, I think, for every developer to have a good separate IDFs for like your development environment, your test environment, your acceptance testing, etc., etc. So you will always know in which IDF you are working at the moment. So it's time for part four, the demo. How are we doing on
there's some questions. I don't know if you can see Chris's PC, but there's some questions about the H move and V move. I don't know if you're going to cover that with your demo.
Yeah, we I have a screen which demos the H move and the V move. So perhaps we can do the demo and then see if that's answer enough. Anything else?
No, there's one question about the color handling, but I need to get an answer for that one, and I'll post the answers in the forums.
And there is a tool for step 2 and 3, right? That you just showed?
Yes. There is not for all steps a tool, but I think steps 1 up until 5 have tools. But you will see that in the demo shortly anyway. So, I have to quickly switch over to a virtual machine and stop presenting my PowerPoint. So I suggest for you people to take a sip of your tea or your coffee, and I will be back shortly.